Okay, this problem involves determining a Langmuir-Hinshelwood mechanism and then testing that mechanism for agreement with some experimental data using a differential reactor. And so we'll quickly start by setting up the Langmuir-Hinshelwood problem in sort of a step-by-step fashion. In part A, we're basically supposed to develop a proposed mechanism. And we have one step, which is identified as the rate determining step, and that's step two. And in the Langmuir-Hinshelwood rate type expression, then what we'll do is we'll assume that this irreversible reaction is elementary as written. And so the overall rate of the reaction will be equal to some rate constant for the surface reaction times the concentration of A, our reactant, that's adsorbed on the surface, squared. We, of course, can't measure very easily the concentration of A that's adsorbed on the surface. And so what we want to be able to derive is how that rate can be expressed in terms of things like partial pressures in the gas phase that are more easy to measure and design a reactor for. And so to do that, we'll make equilibrium assumptions for all the other steps. And so we assume that these steps are fast relative to the rate determining step, and therefore that they go to equilibrium. And we'll define equilibrium constants for each of those steps. So for example, we can define an equilibrium constant for adsorption of the product A, which will be equal to the concentration of A on the surface divided by the partial pressure of A times the concentration of vacant sites on the surface. And similarly, we can write an expression for B. And here we've chosen to write the forward reaction for adsorption of B as in the conventional way for a Langmuir-type mechanism, where the reactants is shown here. So we're writing our equilibrium constant for adsorption rather than desorption. And so the product is BS. It doesn't actually affect the results of the problem if you define the equilibrium constant the other way. Just change the appearance of the final answer slightly in terms of getting a reciprocal of that equilibrium constant. From these equilibrium expressions, we can develop more useful expressions. So we can solve for the of CAS, okay, which is done pretty simply, and CBS. And now what we'll do is a site balance. And so we'll remember that the total concentration of sites is equal to the concentration of vacant sites plus the concentration of sites that contain A plus the concentration of sites that contain B. You can just plug in the expression shown over here for concentration of A that's adsorbed on the surface and concentration of B that's adsorbed on the surface. And we see that there's a concentration of vacant sites in both of those and in the first term. And so we'll just factor that out to give us a concentration of vacant sites times 1 plus KAPA plus KBPB. Okay, now we can go back to our original rate expression and we'll just write that in terms of the concentration of AS so that we'll get the following. Okay, where now we've related that concentration of AS to the concentration of vacant sites. And we've already determined the concentration of vacant sites from this expression shown here in terms of the total concentration of sites. And so substituting in that expression, we end up with the expression shown here that we expect the rate to be proportional to the partial pressure of A squared in the numerator. But then we have a denominator term corresponding to coverage of different types of species where the 1 is proportional to the concentration of vacant sites, the KAPA is proportional to the concentration of sites containing A, and the KBPB is proportional to the concentration of sites containing B. And now we want to see how this stacks up in comparison to our experimental data that are measured in a differential reactor. Okay, when we look at this, at the experimental data shown here, what we observe is that we can find some points where the partial pressure of A, for example, when going from here to here, is doubled, or in this case, tripled, while the partial pressures of B and C are kept at 0 for those 3 data points. And so what we see is that when the partial pressure of A goes up by a factor of 2, that the rate goes up by a factor of 4. Right, so we see that the rate goes from about 10 to about 40, and that when the partial pressure of A goes up by a factor of 3 from the top point to the bottom point, right, then the rate goes up by a factor of 9. All right, so in other words, there's a square dependence of the rate on the partial pressure. And so that makes sense in terms of this model if this is the based on this proportionality, so we have the partial pressure of A squared as a dependence, if the partial pressure of A is not largely covering the surface, so if this term is very small compared to the other terms, right, then we would expect that we could observe this kind of dependence on the partial pressure of A. All right, then we see that the partial pressure of C, we have a data point where everything is held constant except for the partial pressure of C, which goes from 0 to 1. This does not appear to affect the rate at all, right, so it stays at around 40 in arbitrary units. And then we do have a data point where the partial pressure of B goes up from 0 to 1, and the measured rate is affected by that, so it goes down. All right, and that indicates that there's some importance of the partial pressure of B in the denominator here, that it's not very, very small compared to 1. But then again, we don't see a very large decrease. So if this were the dominant term, for example, and we increase the partial pressure of B, right, then we would expect that because of this square dependence, we could have a very large decrease in the rate. And we don't observe that. All right, so the partial pressure, so this term has some importance with respect to 1 under the experimental conditions, but it's not a dominant term. And so overall, what we expect to see is that this 1 under most of the conditions is the dominant term in the denominator. And so we therefore expect that vacant sites, which is what that term stands in for, are the dominant sites under the conditions under which these experimental measurements were made.